Hi guys, my name is Bife here, but call me James for this particular video. Before anything else, I want to talk very candidly about something very close to my heart and to everything that I create, which is music. Video game soundtracks in particular are incredible because they're designed to inspire a very specific emotion at a certain point in time. But when music's really, really well constructed, it can do so much more. It's a canvas for the mind to draw on, and it can make us ask questions about ourselves. For me, it's something that helped me pull through bouts of depression and has inspired me to great heights. Anyone who's lived with depression or anyone who knows the feeling of being really inspired to create something can understand how powerful the music I'm talking about really is. Without a doubt, the musician that's had the greatest impact on me as a gamer and as a listener is Martin O'Donnell. For those of you who don't know who Martin O'Donnell is, he is the original composer behind the soundtracks of Myth, Oni, Halo, and Destiny. Before his time making video game soundtracks, he composed for TV and commercials for 15 years. Marty is a true legend of the industry, and he's even had the chance to work with Paul McCartney. It's also well worth noting that he's a personal hero of mine. After his departure from Bungie Studios, Marty teamed up with a host of other industry veterans to form Highwire Games, a studio that's currently working on a new title for PlayStation VR called Golem. Marty's plan for Golem as audio director of Highwire Games is not only to bring the same level of near unprecedented musical talent to Golem, but is also to create a musical prequel to the game called Echoes of the First Dreamer, which is currently in the process of being funded on Kickstarter. To those of you who enjoy Marty's music, I say this. You haven't seen this just yet, potentially, but it's something that you will probably want to back. I was fortunate enough to get a chance to sit down with Marty and talk about making music for the games industry, for Halo, for Destiny, for Golem, and in particular, I wanted to talk about Echoes of the First Dreamer. This is that interview. So, firstly, Marty, thank you so much for agreeing to talk to me. It's a real pleasure to sit down and talk with such a renowned composer, frankly.
Thank you, James. It's my privilege to be here. Hey, what time is it there, by the way? Because we're on like opposite ends of the world, right?
Oh, yeah. This is currently 8:30 in the evening for me, so it's
okay.
Ever so slightly different, but, you know, yeah. I work this on a regular basis for YouTube, and almost all of the people who I'm friends with in various gaming communities are somewhere in the United States, so...
Yeah. 8 hours. All right, that's not bad.
Yeah, it's okay. It works out. But aside from, you know, gaming history, there's a few games that we really want to talk about. And one of them in particular, it's got to be Golem. But I think the first thing that has to be asked is this. If there are people out there who have previously listened to your work, whether it's in Halo or Myth or Destiny, are they going to enjoy their experience when listening to your music in Golem and Echoes of the First Dreamer?
Of course, I certainly hope so. I'm not necessarily trying to hearken back to like, well, I know people like this or I know people like that. I'm trying to be true to this new world that we're creating. I'm still the composer, and apparently there's a lot of similarities between things I compose, even for different things. So, you know, if you think about the idea that Halo 3 ODST was coming from a very different place musically, it still seemed to fit within the you know, ethos or whatever of what people liked. So I'm hoping something new happens, and I certainly still hope it's likable.
Mm. It's great that you bring up ODST, you know, because it strikes me that you have something really unique here in the composition for Golem compared to previous pieces. Mm-hmm. You know, Halo and Destiny, their soundtracks, they have their much more quiet and reflective moments, but at their core, they're action-packed, they're bombastic, they're loud, and they're proud to say that we're here and we're making great music. Golem feels a lot closer to Halo 3 ODST just because it is a much more intimate and quiet experience.
Right.
So, what are the key differences between composing for something like Golem and composing for a large action game? Is it a different set of ideas or goals or even philosophies or inspirations behind this music?
Yeah, it's all of the above. That's a good question. I've been thinking a lot about it because I'm still in the middle of composing, but it's a much smaller scale story. We are not romping around the galaxy saving mankind and other alien races or whatever. This is a very, very small, it's a story about a family, you know, it's two siblings, a father, what's happened to the mother, you know, a mysterious ancient city, magic powers. And it doesn't get a whole lot bigger than that. And that's on purpose. Both Jamie and I, Jamie Griesmer, who I've worked with for years at Bungie, who also is now independent and we've started the company together. We were just sort of, tired of saving the universe over and over again. Mm. Not that there's anything wrong with saving the universe, but we thought let's tell a more intimate story and see what happens. Mm. So as soon as you start with that, I'm thinking about just everything sort of being scaled down and melodies being more intimate and not quite so bombastic and heroic. And of course, I've had moments like that, like you said, in ODST and even moments in the Halo series and Destiny. But I think there's probably going to be more of that. And then from a production standpoint, you know, the last big production thing we did was with Destiny and Music of the Spheres. And that was 2 years of work, and Paul McCartney and Mike were in on that. Mike Salvatore. You know, I worked with Paul at Capitol Records in LA. We went to Avatar Studios in New York. We were in Abbey Road a couple of times. And you know, trust me, we don't have that kind of budget, let alone, I don't think it calls for that. This is not what this is going to be. It's going to be, I'm going to keep it local in terms of the musicians I know here in the Seattle Pacific Northwest. And, excuse me, and just try to do something a lot more intimate.
Mm, so less of a breadth of experience and more of a depth to one, I suppose.
Yeah, that's a good way to put it. Yeah, I like that. Mm. I put that on my site.
So, when people hear something from Halo's soundtrack, it brings back, for the most part, this really deep and very instant sense of recognition. You know, I guess the best example of this, of course, as everyone I'm sure has told you, is the main Halo theme and the Chanting Monks. But does Golem have that equivalent iconic sound to it? And is there something which people can point to and very specifically say, yes, that is the work of Martin O'Donnell?
Well, that sort of remains to be seen. I like that happening somewhat organically, but even so, which means that once a lot of music has been produced or melodies have been created, I never know exactly what's going to sort of, catch on with the fans. I certainly hope something does. I certainly will throw some things out there that are, you know, have a likelihood of having that happen. But even on the trailer that we've released for Golem so far, I think just this, the humming melody, this sort of haunting humming. So it's very simple. It's like a little lullaby. It might be slightly, you know, reminding you of childhood and maybe something slightly ominous sort of creeping in. I don't know. I don't want to define what people think about that, but I think that's a good hook. Mm. So we'll see. Maybe that's the hook.
You're absolutely correct. I couldn't agree more. It's something that immediately, you know, I saw the trailer first actually at a PSX of this year, and my goodness, that it blew me away. First of all, to find out that it was, you know, coming to PlayStation, because that's, for the most part, it's the console and the platform that I've transitioned to. But not just that, to see Highwire's name up on that stage, you know, I think I was in a group of friends at the time being, and I just sort of, you know, gasped, and they said, what's wrong? And I said, that's Marty's studio, you know, that's Highwire. this is big, guys, you know, turn it up, listen, pay attention.
Well, thank you. I'm glad to know that that's, it's so funny, you know, coming from a giant studio, you know, first of all, you know, Bungie being the little studio that could back in the Chicago days, and then being bought by Microsoft and being part of the launch of the Xbox. And then we were integral to the launch of the Xbox 360. And of course, Halo went on to still be very important. It's still very important to Xbox One. And then Bungie doing Destiny and being part of Activision. You know, the idea of having to get your message out was no longer on my shoulders. So for the last 17 years, there were people who took care of that stuff. And it's been fun, I think, for both Jamie and I. Jamie coming from Bungie, Microsoft, and Bungie Activision Destiny, and then going from there to Sucker Punch doing Second Son, Infamous 2 Second Son. So we both have been for a long time in AAA production and having to worry about how to get the message out, which just wasn't on our shoulders. And it's a big world out there, and it's good to know that so there are fans that will actually look for where we are and help us out. So I appreciate this, James. I really do.
Well, it's our pleasure and it's our passion. I mean, you can't really control what happens with the fans after that, you know.
That's true.
When you're hooked, you're hooked, and that's kind of the end of it, really.
Wow, great.
Mm. So with regards to you know, the fact that Golem is coming out to PlayStation and specifically PlayStation VR, I can imagine that some of the biggest challenges for you as the audio director behind a game like this are primarily working with the new space of VR. So what are some of those challenges that, you know, working in a virtual reality space has presented as far as audio is concerned?
Well, you know, we have worked with the concept of 360-degree audio since Xbox One, when Dolby Surround Sound shipped with the Xbox, the original Xbox. I'm sorry, I always get that mixed up. I say Xbox One, I mean the actual original Xbox.
Yeah.
I don't know why. I'm not going to complain, but it's always confusing to me. So from an audio standpoint, I've spent the last, you know, 16 years thinking about surround sound and placing sound in a three-dimensional space. But we've never known where your ears actually are. All we knew is where the sweet spot was on the couch. We knew hopefully where surround sound speakers were. And as an experience, though, you were always looking through basically into a world through a window in front of you, which is your TV screen. So what's sort of fun about this is in virtual reality, the visuals are essentially catching up with where the audio has been for a while. You're immersed in the audio, and now you're immersed in the world visually at the same time. Mm. But the increase in technology is that there's a camera pointing at your head, and I know where your ears are. I know how your head is tilted. I know everything about it. So the technology to actually have three-dimensional audio in your headphones or even coming from speakers. As a matter of fact, I'm working with some three-dimensional audio that can come out of two stereo speakers. It's fascinating whether or not, you know, this is ships in the first iteration of these games. I think this is going to be some technology down the road that's pretty amazing. We'll see.
I can imagine.
But anyway, that's the hard part is sort of getting all of the programs that need to talk to each other. Like we're using Unreal 4, we're using Wyze, which is third party software, middleware for audio. And of course we're using PlayStation 4 and PlayStation VR hardware. So getting all of that stuff to talk together and actually making it work great it takes some work and some getting used to. But I gotta tell you, it's pretty stinking cool. I love it.
Damn. I wish I could have at least sat there and been part of an experience like that, you know, being on the very cusp of something new in gaming like this. But I mean, really, this brings us to something which is a dream that you've had for quite a long time, and which is really something novel in itself, which is Echoes of the First Dreamer, which is what you're basically kickstarting at this exact moment. And it's going to
Yes.
be, yeah, independent from Golem, something that, you know, if it doesn't get funded for whatever reason, you know, Golem's not going to be impacted. And more importantly, you get that alongside the soundtrack of Golem as well. So, you know, in a sense, it's fantastic because it's twice the Marty.
Yes.
But you've always stated that, you know, this is a project that you want to see out there in the world, and it does strike me as a really unique concept. And there have been attempts by a whole variety of games to make these kind of prequels to their product, where, you know, they're these kind of standalone additions to a universe. So I think some of the craziest and, like, large budget examples that you can find of this are in the newer iterations of Halo by 343, where, you know, you've seen entire films dedicated to just, you know, setting up a few characters and embellishing the world. But why specifically was music the right choice for Golem? And, you know, what inspired you really to say that, yes, this is the time that we should be putting this project into place?
Well, this was Jamie's sort of instigation. Jamie sort of caught me as soon as I found myself free from Bungie, so to speak, And he knew that I had had a vision for Destiny. And I had told the world for a couple of years that there would be a musical prequel to Destiny called Music of the Spheres, which still exists. It's completed. It's been completed for almost 4 years. You know, it's a collaboration between Mike and I and Paul McCartney. It's 8 movements. One of these days, we'll no longer ever be able to be the musical prequel to Destiny, but however it's released, it should be released. It's something that I and Mike and Paul also work really hard on. Bungie spent a lot of money on it. You know, for whatever reasons, it hasn't been released yet, and I wish it was. I hope it will be eventually. I know it will be eventually. But because it was, I thought, a great idea for Destiny, and we didn't get to do it, in terms of releasing it to the public, Jamie said, well, hey, let's do it for Golem. And I'm like, oh, okay, let's try it again. Let's see what happens. It won't be on quite as a massive scale production wise, but, what I think is interesting about this is that people tend to like the music when they've listened to it and played a game. There's equity, like you said. You hear the music and you have memories of whatever you felt like when you first heard the music playing the game. And that's a very powerful thing. And what I'd love to be able to try is sort of do that in reverse and see if people listen to the music by itself, if it conjures up images and stories and so forth and emotions, in your head. And then there will be echoes of those emotions when you play the game, and it'll be subtly different. And there might be new themes that come in for the game itself, but there's this sort of emotional world that you'll be living in, prior to actually playing the game, which, you know, isn't that difficult to create. And I've also noticed that music lives beyond the game. I had this experience just a few weeks ago. I'm teaching at a place here in Seattle called DigiPen, and it's a game studio. It's a full 4-year school that teaches all the arts and sciences of game creation. But there was a class sort of on the history of games, and they wanted me to talk about Halo, the first Halo, Combat Evolved. And I said, oh, well, to really do it justice, I need the original Xbox, the original, you know, cables that allow you to go into 5.1 audio and probably would even look better on an NTSC monitor. And it was almost impossible to put all that together. Like, nobody could find the multimedia pack cable that came with that first Xbox. And I realized that playing games the way they were originally intended gets harder and harder as technology starts advancing. And we are starting to lose those games in terms of how they were originally experienced. But the music, you don't lose. That's the nice thing. Music lives beyond the technology of the game and, can conjure up all the happy memories for people when they hear the music by itself. Mm-hmm. So anyway, that makes my life easier. And it'd be fun to see what happens if you start with music.
Absolutely. Now, Echoes of the First Dreamer, it's on Kickstarter right now. And by the looks of things, it very well could get published, which is fantastic to see, of course. But what are some of the perks that people are going to get if they support the Kickstarter?
Well, of course, at the high level, you can actually show up at one of the recording sessions and see what it's like to watch me and my friends record music. But below that, you can get a package that you'll get the sheet music from, or the scores, basically, the printed scores from the sessions, that of course I'll be happy to sign. The signed CD, a vinyl version, a high res, high def, digital version. And then of course, just the normal, at the lowest level, you get the good, you know, AAC, whatever that is, iTunes approved digital version of the full score. And I think there's some t-shirts that are thrown in there that should be really cool. And don't know what else there is. I think there's something.
there's something for loyal members of the Marty Army at basically every single level of payment, right?
Good.
So, in as many or as few sentences as you want, why should people back Echoes of the First Dreamer? And what would it mean to you to see, you know, this massive project, this dream, really become a reality?
Well, it would mean a lot to me, and of course a lot to the small team that we have over at Highwire Games. So we're only up to, I think, 11 people. We're not going to get much bigger than that. We're dipping our toe into some really new technology that has some interesting problems that we need to solve. I think people's backing and basically pre-ordering the soundtrack or the music and being willing to step up to say, yeah, we believe in you guys and we believe that this music is going to be cool. It just helps us to connect with the fans out there and know that they care about what we're trying to do. And also, I think it lets us know that the fans care about the people who make games rather than just the corporations who essentially ship games. I hope that doesn't sound too cynical, but you know, I for a long time I've just felt like the creatives behind all of these things are the people who a lot of times are unsung. I've gotten a lot of press over the years, and that's great. I'll take advantage of it, and I'm taking advantage of it for Highwire. But there are people at Highwire who have been in the trenches for years and years, just doing incredible art, and they're incredibly creative. And you know, they deserve, you know, the recognition and the love from the fans too. So, this actually will help us as a team realize that people care.
Wow. That's so fantastic to hear. Marty, thank you again so much for sitting down with me, and I hope Echoes of the First Dreamer and Golem are going to be a fantastic success.
Oh, thanks very much, James. Appreciate it.
So there you have it, guys. That has to be one of the coolest things I've ever done on YouTube, full stop. However, Echoes of the First Dreamer won't happen without your support. Head over to Marty's Kickstarter, which is the first link in the description below, and you'll be able to back his project and receive backer rewards from t-shirts to, as we mentioned in the interview, a trip to Seattle. The lowest tier of rewards is automatically going to get you a download code for Echoes of the First Dreamer, so you can listen to the music when it's finished. However, if you guys aren't able to back Marty's Kickstarter, you can still definitely help out in a few ways. Firstly, I'm going to take the money that I make from this video, seeing as it is monetized, and I'm going to donate it to Marty's Kickstarter on top of my own contribution that I've already made. However, the rewards that that money earns from you guys is going to be put into a prize which you guys will be eligible to win. So let's say, feasibly, there is some kind of point at which we all somehow manage to create $1,500 worth of revenue, you will be going out to see all of this happen, the recording and whatnot, and if there are any other expenses, I will cover them. So, yeah, cool for you guys. If not, I mean, there's still a chance for you to win some really cool stuff like t-shirts and vinyls and whatnot. So, the way you're eligible to win that is simply like this video, comment on it, and share it with your friends on social media. Get the word out there, and we might well be able to help just create something incredible. Thank you so much for all your support, and thank you for watching. But in the meantime, my name is Bife. Prodossia ad Astra. I'll see you again very soon.